Andrea Steiner, I'm the president of the United Nations Association of San Francisco chapter. Our chapter and our organization was founded in 1943 and was the predecessor, the predication, for the founding of the United Nations here in San Francisco. Ironically, while the United States prides itself in advising other countries about how to enforce and implement human rights, we here have had the experience in the Bay Area of being visited by a UN Special Rapporteur. He is Philip Alston, and his report is up at the front table. It's an extensive report, and some of it's good news. Lots of good things are happening, and you can see at the back of the room, lots of good things are happening with nonprofits just pitching in and lending a hand and saying, if the government won't do it, we'll do it. And so we have that incredible spirit with us this evening. We also have some bad news, and the bad news is that we see it very visibly on our streets here in San Francisco, and we're aware of the long food lines of people who are hungry, and we're even becoming aware that our students in universities are food insecure, maybe as many as 20% are food insecure, and maybe as many as 40% have experienced homelessness at one time. So it's affecting everyone, and it could be me, it could be someone else in this room that suddenly has that traumatic experience. So we were looking at 20 topics dealing with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We started this series and said it was going to be about homelessness, and lo and behold, it's turning out to be a very pivotal time in the city for public policy and dealing with this situation. And Nelson did agree to take on this topic and to put together this incredible panel and all of these incredible nonprofit organizations. It is Nelson's generosity and his willingness to spend maybe 50% of his time putting this incredible program together. Nelson Berry.
We're very fortunate to have this opportunity to, on behalf of the United Nations Association of San Francisco, in conjunction with the American Legion Post 315, to present this program in our continuing series on human rights. And this year, this month, we're picking homelessness in San Francisco. And it's really a hot topic right now, obviously. Last week, the mayor decided, after getting some bad press from conventioneers, that we may not come back here to San Francisco because it's not really pretty. But what city in America doesn't have a homeless challenge? That's a shot below the belt for us San Franciscans. I'm a native San Franciscan. On my mother's side, we go back 5 generations here in San Francisco. My grandmother, in 1906, on April 18th, was rolled out of bed at the age of 11 onto the floor of the 1906 earthquake. And for the next several decades, they rebuilt San Francisco from Venice Avenue all the way to the Bay, because that's how much of the city was destroyed. And that's the can-do attitude we have. And just 40 years later, in 1945, the United Nations Declaration was signed in this building downstairs, a proud history that we have. And 4 years later, in 1949, the Universal Declaration on Human Rights was promulgated. And number 25 says, I want to get it right. Article 25 of the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights leads off by saying, everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and his family. Kind of says something about the day and age. including food, clothing, housing, and medical care. 1945. We live in a time when social services are being cut at the federal level, so more pressure is on the cities and states to pick up the slack. But San Francisco has wonderful men and women who are at the forefront of dealing with social issues like homelessness, and we have some of the best here today representing dozens of organizations that are working hard to bring some compassion and treat homeless people in a humane, compassionate way. Some of those people, as Mary said, are represented by the organizations in the back of the room. I hope you'll stop by and talk to each and every one of them. Miracle Messages teaches you how to, they give you an app, and you on your own phone, when you encounter a homeless person, you can say to them, have you talked to your family in a while? Would you like to talk to your family? And if they don't, yeah, I might, but I don't know how to get a hold of them. So Miracle Messages teaches you how to find people, and then you use the app, and it doesn't cost you anything, it doesn't cost you a dime. And you can put that person in touch with their family, and they've reunited many, many homeless people with their families just through that little act of kindness using a little bit of technology. And we have Project Homeless Connect, which is, I'm gonna give it a general overview, but I love this organization because of what they do. They go out and they find homeless people who have particular needs, and there are dozens of organizations out there to help the homeless, and they try to direct the person to the organization that's going to help them with that particular need, be it help with mental health issues or drug addiction, or they need job skills, or they need medical care. Then the list goes on. So we've got lots of organizations here that are doing really great. Now our speakers represent perhaps the granddaddy of all of our organizations, the San Francisco Coalition on Homelessness. Yay. Also Project Homeless Connect. And another stalwart of our city, the St. Anthony's Foundation. And something that touches my heart, because my father was a veteran, Swords to Plowshares. And our panel is also very fortunate to be rounded out by a very experienced San Franciscan in the area of homelessness, and that would be Angela Alioto, who is a civil rights attorney and president of the Board of Supervisors. And she has a wealth of knowledge about the history of homelessness and how it's been addressed in San Francisco, and has very strong opinions about that, which you may have heard this week. Now, it's a secret that Angela's running for mayor. But Angela's not here today as a campaign stop. She's here today not in her capacity as a mayoral candidate. She's here to talk about a San Franciscan with a heart and with good ideas and good and experience to draw upon to help the homeless people in San Francisco and the organizations that are working hard to make it happen. So I'm going to introduce our speakers just quickly. I'm not going to give you their full bios just yet, because I'll do that just before they come up individually. So our first speaker, if you could stand up, is Jennifer Friedman. And Jennifer is the executive director of the Granddaddy Organization, San Francisco Coalition on Homelessness. Or should I say Grandmother Organization? Okay, and then Megan Friedman is the CEO of Project Homeless Connect. Simply the Basics a few years ago, which is also at the Project Homeless Connect table if you want to find out some information about that. And then the stalwart organization, the St. Anthony's Foundation, is represented by Colleen Rebecca. And Michael Bleeker is representing Swords to Plowshares. And Angela Alioto is representing compassionate people in San Francisco who care about homelessness. Latina photographer and artist who is going to be putting, you're going to see her photo montage on homelessness in San Francisco. Welcome, Calusa Chirnos. Now, we're going to have some question and answer period. I'm just going to take 2 seconds and explain how that works. Two people are going to hand out index cards. Could you guys come up here, the ones that are handing out index cards, so people can see you? That would be Elsia and Mokhtar. So if you have a question, just raise your hand. We'll give you an index card. We have pens as well. Elsia's in the back. She has cards and pens as well. And then when you're ready to turn your question in, just raise it and they'll come around and pick it up. And we'll try to handle as many of the questions as we can, but I guarantee you we won't get to all of that. We may only get to 2 or 3 or 4, and I apologize for that. So feel free to come up afterwards and address the speakers and address with your questions directly. So that's how that works. Okay, so I'd like to invite up Jennifer, and while she's setting up, I'm going to just say a little bit about her. So come on up and applause. Okay, so I've been trying to research a little bit about Jennifer. I found very little about her because I think she's rather selfish. She's called a champion of the San Francisco homeless. She's been with the San Francisco Coalition on Homelessness for 30 years. She's been described as passionate, organized, whip-smart, hardworking, and courageous. The article that I read said back in 2012 she was only being paid $22,000 a year because she didn't want to take money out of the organization, and everybody else in the organization was working a very low wages because their heart was in their work. She's truly a human rights advocate who walks the talk, and she's been demonstrating this for a long, long time. I found a quote that she said, "I saw working in homelessness all these different kinds of oppressions, poverty, the impact on people of color, people with disabilities, single women. It was like a last frontier for anti-hate work. People were compared to trash, objects to be swept along." That was back in 2012, and you know what happened just last week. We're still sweeping this problem along. So please give a warm welcome to Jennifer.
Thanks, everyone. So happy to be here. One of the other reasons that I do this work is that, for me, home is really important. And as a mom, as a place where me and my family can center, and this morning I was, able to take a shower. I spent most of the morning cleaning and, really grateful for that. And all of us as humans really need a home and deserve a home. When we talk about homelessness in the United States, it's really a tale of two acts. And if we go back to our last episode of mass homelessness, it was after, the Great Depression, and we had over 1 million men, women, and children in the United States that were experiencing homelessness. We did a series of things in this country to address that. We did Social Security, we did what later became AFDC, but was at that time a widower's pension. We had a works program, but the big, big thing we did is that we invested in housing. We had the Housing Act of 1937, which is to remedy the unsafe and unsanitary housing conditions and the acute shortage of decent, safe, and sanitary dwellings for families of lower income. We committed, as a country, to house everyone in the United States. And when you then fast forward to our kind of Act Two in 1998, we changed that. And we said the federal government cannot, through its direct action alone, provide housing for all of its citizens. When we look at homelessness over this arc of time, we can see what happened, where we invested in housing, where we were able to address that homeless crisis, and then starting in the late 1970s, we started to divest from housing. So that basically, by the time we hit 1983, we had cut our housing budget by almost 78%. 78%. we completely divested from housing. And so in the early 80s, we suddenly saw men, women, and children experiencing homelessness at these large mass numbers that we hadn't seen since the Great Depression. We opened up our first shelters here in San Francisco and across the country, and our response was basically an emergency response. We thought it would go away by opening up a few shelters. What we've done instead of that, as our local municipalities have gotten frustrated by the lack of a federal response, they've turned to criminalization, right? And so in San Francisco, we've spent over $20.6 million doing something that is completely ineffective, citing homeless people, moving them along with nowhere for them to go, arresting them. We have put arrest warrants out on people who couldn't pay their fines. They end up doing jail time. We had a major victory last year where we finally got the courts to stop issuing arrest warrants for impoverished people who had tickets for camping. But these situations destroy people's credit. You get kicked off the federal housing wait list and a lot of our local wait lists, and it basically hurts us and makes people stay homeless longer. But it's also our primary response. If I had called the city this morning because I was worried about somebody who was out in front of my house, or maybe I just wanted them to move along, you know, depending on what the neighbor's perspective is, if I call the city, they send a police officer. That's our response in San Francisco right now. And it's not the right response. So what are we doing in San Francisco? I think it's important to note, because we look around on our streets and we're so frustrated. What we hear over and over again is that we're spending so much money on homelessness and it's not getting us anywhere, right? Has everyone heard that? So we actually spend 3% of our city's budget on homelessness, 3%. But what we do with that money is we house about 7,000 people. About half of that is in supportive housing. The other half is master leasing and single room occupancy hotels or residential hotels. We also have 2,500 short-term beds. About 1,200 of those are the traditional shelter beds, but we also have transitional housing, navigation center beds, respite beds that are short-term in different hotels. And so if we weren't doing this, can you imagine how much worse it would look out there? It would look a lot worse. That said, we're not doing enough, not nearly enough. And we have this benefit in San Francisco that although we have a severe housing crisis, we also have a lot of wealth in San Francisco. So we kind of have an advantage over a lot of the other municipalities that don't have our tax base. We actually have a very good tax base in San Francisco. So who's homeless in San Francisco? We talked about the people who were housed. So the people who are still not housed, we have at any one time about 7,000 people who are homeless. The homeless department started tracking things over the course of the year, and they're finding about 21,000 people are homeless over the course of the year. 30% of them were experiencing it for the first time. So let's say of those, of that group, you've got a third that are first-time homeless. The overwhelming majority became homeless as housed San Franciscans. You guys hear me? They became homeless as housed San Franciscans. This is really, really key. Because when we're talking about addressing homelessness, we have to keep our people in their homes. We gotta make sure they don't lose their homes. We gotta make sure when you have an elder whose rent is slowly climbing up above their fixed income, that we have some kind of subsidy to keep them in their home, or someone has a loss of a life partner, or some other major tragedy. They get, they're working and they get injured and their income drops significantly. All of that, we need to make sure that folks stay in their homes. We also have, and this is something, as I've been doing this work for the past 20 some odd years, as we've done the point in time count, the number of people with disabilities has risen and risen. We have a very large population with really significant impairments. It's just heartbreaking. It's also heartbreaking that we have over 3,300 homeless kids in San Francisco. In San Francisco Unified Public Schools, 1 in 25 school kids are experiencing homelessness. We have only about one shelter for every 6 homeless people. And this other piece is really important. So at the point of entry into homelessness, there's no difference between housed poor people and people who are poor and homeless, except for whether or not they have a housing subsidy. There's no greater level of other socioeconomic indicators on the homeless side. No greater levels of mental illness, domestic violence, substance abuse, unemployment, all those other things that we talk about. But as time goes on, we're devastating people. We're absolutely devastating people. My heart almost stopped when I saw this study from UCSF. They did the study in Oakland, so very close to home, and it was a very intensive study of the homeless population, and they found that homeless people were responding 25 years senior their calendar year. 25 years in every health area. So a 50-year-old woman is presenting to the doctor as a 75-year-old woman. It's crazy. So everything, responsiveness, diabetes, heart disease, all these different things that we look at that happen as we get older are happening that much faster for folks on the streets. Our lack of action is literally killing people, literally killing them. And another piece here is that we've got a lot of different people who are overrepresented in our homeless population. African Americans are much overrepresented, 40 to 50% of our population. Homeless population is African American compared to 5% of the city's population. Latinos is about double. Our LGBT population is more than double. About a third of the homeless population identifies as LGBT. On the family side, it's overwhelmingly single women who end up experiencing homelessness. And so you have all these folks that have experienced these different forms of oppression that are then appearing in our homeless population. So when we get things, when things happen, like what happened this last week with Mayor Farrell, you know, and he's putting out a lot of nasty rhetoric against homeless people, who is he talking about? He's talking about people of color. He's talking about people with disabilities. He's talking about members of the queer community. It's not acceptable. So this is just another kind of illustration to look at the homeless families. So we have enough kids to fill 70 classrooms. And the impact on kids is really dramatic. And I'll just point out a couple of these, but 87% increased chance of dropping out of schools. This held back one is a mom, this one kills me. 50% of homeless kids are held back one grade. 22% held back more than one. So as we're failing to address homeless kids, we're creating this pipeline into homelessness later. Also, another situation I just want to talk about a little bit is for women out there, it's really, really a struggle. And a lot of history of physical and sexual trauma, and then a lot of trauma on the streets because they're very susceptible. I also wanted to point that out today because one of the things that keeps happening in this debate is this throwing out of the word rape and throwing it out against homeless people. And people may have heard Mayor Farrell say that some of the people are staying on the streets because they're rapists. He said to the KRON interview this last week. And also during Prop Q, it got brought up a lot. He wanted to take away the tents because he said that homeless women were getting raped as a result of living in the tents. And so we went out and talked to homeless women about this, and what they told us was is that when they're sleeping on the sidewalk exposed, they feel a lot more unsafe because everyone walking by can see that they're a woman lying there. And when they're inside a tent, people walking by that might be potential perpetrators don't know who's inside that tent. And so it's just, I wanted to bring that up because it keeps being talked about publicly right now. Another big piece of our problem is these massive cuts to mental health and substance abuse. And you know, everyone talks about the deinstitutionalization. San Francisco in the 70s, we had a flourishing mental health system. We lost it. We had massive losses in this last recession between 07 and 12. 40 million direct cuts to substance abuse and mental health treatment within the Department of Public Health. 40 million just in San Francisco. So this other piece around youth, about half of our homeless population become homeless as under the age of 25. So when we talk about policy and we're talking about how we're approaching homelessness, and when I went on that previous slide, when I talked about how many units of housing we're providing, only 14% of that housing is for families with kids, very little of it, and very little for youth. We've basically been ignoring those two populations, and when we go out on the streets, you know, had we been addressing it 20 years ago, we wouldn't see those same people out there now. And so that's a huge issue as well. And it's important to remember that youth are, you know, often thrown out of their homes and or fleeing persecution as an LGBT person, or, you know, all these other things. We can go one more. So where we need to be, where we need to be in San Francisco is we need to end homelessness. And we bring that up, it's like, oh, you'll never end homelessness, that's crazy. So what are we talking about when we're talking about ending homelessness? This is our vision, and we have done it before in this country, so it shouldn't be too crazy, right? We can do it again. So what it means, thank you, what it means is that we prevent as much homelessness as possible, so all the people we can keep in their homes, we keep in their homes, but we know some people will still become homeless, domestic violence, fires, these other things that happen, and when they become homeless, it's rare and it's brief, and within 6 months, they're back in housing. They don't have to wait for shelter right now. We have 1,000 people on our wait list for shelter in San Francisco for families. It's an average wait of over 100 days. So the key to addressing homelessness is to do these different pieces, to halt those preventable housing loss, to expand shelter, to get rid of our wait list, to ensure healthy conditions while people are forced on the streets, throw up some porta potties, garbage service, give people brooms and garbage bags, pick it up regularly, access to water, just the basic fundamental human rights that all human beings deserve in any kind of encampment or informal settlement situation. Invest in housing opportunities. We have to make sure that we do this. We have homeless preferences for public housing, so when those open up, homeless people can move in. We can master lease all the empty. We have over 1,000 empty shelter SRO rooms, and we add additional homeless units to affordable housing and build more supportive housing. And we have to build up that mental health and substance abuse system. I want to end by saying this is possible to do. We are going to be moving forward to the November ballot measure, and we're writing a piece that would basically do a very small 5% in context of the tax break from Trump, 35% to 21%, an average of a half of a percent, a 0.5, not 5%, but a 0.5, a half of a percent on all San Francisco businesses earning more than 50 million. Just the income above 50 million, it would bring in enough money to do all those things that was on that list, every one of them. We wouldn't be able to do it overnight, but within 5 years, we would have a huge turnaround in this crisis. We'd be able to definitely end for families and youth, and we'd get really close on the single adults. These are some things to think about. This is on our website, but you know, people always ask what to do when you see a person experiencing homelessness. I'm out of time, but you know, the biggest thing is we're all humans, right? So treat everyone like you'd like to be treated. Treat our homeless neighbors like neighbors. And there's some basic information about where to call. Knowing that, we don't have enough housing or resources for people when you do call, but we want to put pressure on the city to do a whole lot more. Thank you so much.